Thank you all for coming. I'm Linda Iltis, and my background is in Nepal studies, so I was really happy to hear that Bal Gopal Shrestha was coming to Seattle, because I got to know him when I was doing my PhD research in Saku, Nepal, which is in the Kathmandu Valley. Since then, Bal Gopal Shrestha he's currently a research associate at the School of Anthropology in Oxford. He's a research fellow at the, he was a research fellow there as well, and he carried out research among the Nepalese diaspora in the UK and in Belgium. And he's now working with diaspora communities in Sikkim as well, and he's got a book that's in progress about Nepalese diaspora ritual transformation in the diaspora, the Nawars in Sikkim in India. His PhD is in anthropology from University of Leiden in the Netherlands. And he has done a lot of research on Nawar culture and rituals in the Kathmandu Valley. He had a fellowship, a Yang Kona fellowship, which is a great honor to do research in Leiden. And he was also awarded the University of Cambridge Frederick Williamson Memorial Fund to carry out research among the diaspora in Sikkim. His talk today is on the cultural impacts of the death of kingship, identity politics, and the current political situation in Nepal. Welcome, Bal Gopal. Also, I should mention his wife, Sri Lakshmi. Where did she go? There she is, for the camera back there. Sri Lakshmi is also a scholar, a literature scholar, and she writes short stories and poetry. I have some of her books studied here just to see them, but we have her book in the library here. And this is Bal Gopal's book on the Sanku, the sacred town of Sanku, where it's how we have to meet. Thank you all for coming in. Let's go to his talk.
Thank you, everybody. I'm delighted to have this opportunity of giving this talk at this prestigious university of the USA to this gathering. Grateful to Linda for inviting me, also Subhas for having me here. In this talk, as Linda explained, I intend to talk on the impact of death of divine kingship in Nepal, especially also on identity politics and again political situation in Nepal. I shall start first on the surviving state of Nepal. Nepal was divided into several tiny monarchical and tribal states before the development of centralized power, feudal power. Historians such as Bhanavajjhaka Jacharji suppose the boundaries of ancient Nepal to be as large as those of present day Nepal. Inscription evidence tells us that rulers in ancient Nepal, such as Mandev and the Anshuvarman, proclaimed themselves to be great feudal masters, Mahasamanta, and were proud of their supremacy and the influence over the lands and the people they ruled. In a later period, Nepal disintegrated into several small states and principalities. These came under the domination of one single administrative unit after the 1769 Gorkha expansion. As elsewhere, the dominance of victors of history is apparent in Nepal. Max Weber's definition of monopoly on the legitimate use of physical force within a given territory is evidence in Nepal. The various janjatis or ethnic nationalities that lost their land to Gorkha Empire and remained oppressed by caste, Brahmin, Kshatri, chauvinism under the pretext of Nepali nationalism are now effectively asserting their distinct national identities by restructuring the state into a federal setup. From the dawn of Nepal's history till today, kings and feudal chiefs controlled the lands and monopolized taxes. They punished and rewarded people as they wished. The king in Nepal behaved no differently than Louis XVI of France, who proclaimed, "I am the state." The king's word was the law. For centuries, state power in Nepal revolved around the kings and the royal palace, and it continued to do so until recent events. The Nepalese kings controlled the sovereignty of the state until political change of 1990 that forced King Virendra to relinquish it, thereby empowering the Nepalese people themselves as the sovereign power. Janjati, the ethnic nationalities in Nepal are furthermore no longer ready to accept centralized state power, rather they desire a decentralized federal state. This development in Nepal feed the arguments of modern day scholars such as Michael Akol, who believe that the notion of a sovereign centralized state is outdated. King Ganendra reclaimed sovereignty when he became king in 2001 and behaved as the center of power, but the Nepalese people discarded him, and the April 2006 People's Movement compelled him to cease his attempt to regain power. Kingship. Ancient Hindu scriptures put the king at the summit of the mechanism of the state. As a ruler, the king was an agent of the gods, a god in himself, or at least supposed to be possessing some divine powers. Divinity gave him highest position in the state of the king. As a king, his duty was to maintain and protect law and order, and no man was supposed to disobey him. It was his divinity that authorized him to reward and punish his subjects and led him to be considered the supreme or sovereign power of the state. The belief in the king as God is a prehistoric tradition in Nepal, and the kings have abided by it in modern times. The Lichabis, who ruled Nepal from 464 to 878 AD, claimed that they were descendants of the god Sun. Their successor, the Thakuri, who ruled Nepal from 1879 till 1200 AD, and the Mallas, who ruled Nepal from 1200 till 1769 AD, made similar claims. The Mallas kings also identified themselves with the terrifying god Bhairava, a form of Lord Shiva. The goddess Talaju was their tutelary goddess. The Malla kings began the tradition of worshipping the living goddess Kuma, believing her to be a manifestation of goddess Talaju in human form. Inhabitants say that the goddess must put tikka, or mark of blessing, on the forehead of reigning king on the last day of the festival of Indra Chakra in Kathmandu in order to re-endorse his rule for the coming year. If she refused, he might lose his king. According to one story, this indeed happened to Jayaprakash, the last Malla king of Kathmandu. Krishnanarayan Shah, the warrior king of the Gurkha, launched a surprise attack on Kathmandu and conquered it on the day that the people were celebrating the festival of Krishnanarayan Shah then arranged for himself to receive tikka from the goddess Kumari, legitimizing his conquest. His descendants continued this tradition. In 2007, however, King Ganendra was denied receiving tikka as the head of state. Instead, Girija Prasad Koirala, the then Prime Minister, as head of state, received tikka from Kumari. King Ganendra's fear and evil spell might affect him if Kumari did not bless him with tikka. However, only after the Prime Minister that King Ganendra went to receive his tikka that year, but it has become more than clear that he lost his legitimacy. After the CA election of Council Assembly in 2008, when the rule of Nepal passed to a president, the former king had to abandon attending any religious and cultural program in the capacity of head of state. Different party has different ideas about federal structure of Nepal. So it's a historical timeline. You can see how Nepal passed through. I'll continue reading the text here. The Gurkha rulers enforced a rule based on Hindu religious scripture that encouraged caste-based hierarchies, discrimination, and of course, Gurkha king's supreme position as a reincarnation of Hindu god Vishnu. The geographical boundaries of Nepal were reduced to their present size when in 1816 they were obliged to sign a treaty with the British Empire. Though Nepal never came directly under British colonial rule, from that point on, its ruler had to obey the British. Internal power struggle between members of Shaha dynasty gave rise to dictator Jang Bahadur Rana. He established the notorious Rana oligarchy in Nepal, ensuing the post of prime minister to his brothers, their sons, and their cousins from 1847 to 1951. As a result of a massive uprising, the Rana oligarchy came to an end on 19 February 1951 and the Nepal achieved democracy. However, after the 1951 scene, as a new democratic country, Nepal had to experience politically unstable period between 1951 and 1951. The conflict among Nepalese parties helped strengthening power of the king. In this way, instead of consolidating democracy, the political change only reinforced the Shah kings. In 1954, with the death of King Tribhuvan, his eldest son Mahendra became the new king. On 12 February 1957, he promulgated a constitution and the first parliamentary election was held in 1959. The Nepali Congress Party, NC, won the election and formed a government. On 15 December 1960, however, Mahendra staged a coup d'etat, dismissed the elected government, banned political parties, and imprisoned all prominent political leaders. Mahendra's dictatorship introduced the panchayat system, which lasted 30 years. This was an attempt to homogenize the country by enforcing the adoption of one religion, Hindu, one language, Khas, as Nepali, one culture, and one nation. Policy under the pretext of Nepali nationalism. It systematically suppressed ethnic languages and culture. In 1971, on the death of King Mahendra, his eldest son Birendra inherited the panchayat system. In 1971, a spontaneous students' protest forced King Birendra to proclaim a referendum seeking the people's opinion as to whether to retain the panchayat system with reform or to reintroduce the multi-party democracy in Nepal. The result announced for the 1980 referendum went in favor of panchayat with reforms, so the political parties once again had to suffer prohibition. In fact, political parties in Nepal didn't consider it as a fair referendum. However, they continued their struggle to restore multi-party system. Finally, on 8 April 1990, a people's movement, Jana Andolan, succeeded at obliging the king to lead the ban on party. Now I shift to the death of divine kingship in Nepal. With the introduction of the 1990 constitution, the powers of king were considerably reduced. However, neither King Birendra nor other royal members took the change easily. In general, King Virendra behaved as a constitutional monarch and acted as a stabilizing factor, but one faction in the palace led by his brother Gyanendra and the queen mother Ratnaradi always opposed the loss of royal power, and they played an active role in weakening political parties so as to regain the lost power of the palace. The modern history of Nepal referred to the palace as the seat of conspiracies. High posts in army were reserved for the relatives of kings and the queens. In the 1st June 2011 royal palace massacre, King Virendra and all the members of his family, his two sisters and a younger brother were killed. The Royal Investigation Commission blamed the Crown Prince Dipendra of committing regicide. He was made the king for 2 days while he was in a coma, before being declared dead. The Nepalese people, however, did not believe the report. Instead, accused Gyanendra, the only surviving brother of King Virendra, who succeeded to the throne, as the murderer. King Gyanendra's multiple business were notorious before he became the king, meaning linked him to underworld traders such as drug trafficking and smuggling of Nepal's ancient traders to underworld to other countries. In addition, his only son, Paras, whom he made the crown prince, is a non-criminal with a record of killings and a brawl in nightclubs. Therefore, the Nepalese people didn't see King Gyanendra and his son Paras as successors to Nepalese throne. In Nepal, succession of kingship is in the line of father to son. Therefore, taking over of throne by a younger brother of the slain King Virendra was unacceptable for Nepalese people. In addition, Nepalese people saw Gyanendra as the murderer of his brother and his entire family, though there is no evidence to prove this. The slaying of the king in a family feud in a country where he was supposed to be an incarnation of Lord Vishnu was astonishing. But the 2001 incident made it clear that divinity did not protect him from his one son or brother, let alone his foe. This naturally shattered traditional faith in the power of the divine king. Even for the most religiously minded people, it was the end of divinity in the king. A widespread myth about the Shah dynasty is that the god Gorkhanath had bestowed King Pritinayan Shah and his descendants with the right to rule Nepal for 10 generations, ending with King Virendra's death. As both of his sons were also killed in the palace massacre, no natural line of succession remained. Therefore, the Nepalese people considered the kingship has lost its authority. Although King Gyanendra has succeeded Virendra, religious people didn't accept him as a true king. Now I talk a little bit about cultural impact after the death of the divine kingship in Nepal. At the peak of the Maoist war, a section of intellectuals and the anthropologists working on Nepal cautiously warned, if the kingship is abolished from Nepal, it will have to see huge consequences in cultural life of the country. For instance, Jeffrey, to whom the royal Kumari would apply Tika if king is removed, who will go to witness Otoja or listen to Basanta music, etc. Against such prediction, however, Nepal didn't have to feel any big disorder on cultural and religious space. Soon after the 2006 political change, we saw Prime Minister Dirja Prasad Koirala began replacing the king in various religious events where it was necessary for the king to play his role. Astonishingly, in 2007, even the king was still here at his palace and the country was yet to declare republic, Prime Minister Dirja Prasad went to receive Tika from the Royal Kumari by effectively preventing King Gyanendra for the same. As soon as the Conscient Assembly elected Dr. Ram Varan Yadav as the first president of Nepal, he began representing the king in cultural and religious affairs. This made it clear that Nepal is capable of moving forward without affecting much to its cultural life in absence of tea. In one instance, however, the Pachari dance performers didn't find it appropriate to invite the president to represent the king during the 12-yearly sword exchange ceremony in 2011. They prepared an empty chair instead to avoid any one outsider to represent the king to keep their tradition on stake. But in other cases, the president easily took over king's role. To mark the beginning of spring, classical music belonging to spring, Basanta Raga, is performed at the Hanuman Bhakas Royal Palace in Kathmandu at the presence of king at an auspicious moment stated by the royal astrologer. However, since 2009, as the country has turned into a republic, the president has replaced the king during this appeal. The reigning king used to observe the festival of Bhaitika by receiving Tika from his sister. Every year, a royal astrologer announces the most auspicious moment to receive Tika from sisters. But apart from the king, people choose here one convenient time of worship. However, with the death of the kingship, no longer astrologers' announcement of auspicious movement for Bhaitika holds any meaning, although the astrologers kept on the tradition of the announcement. Royalty plays a vital role during the procession of Bajrayani. In the past, that is in the Saku small town nearby Kathmandu, in the past, the king himself had to present to please the goddess so that the goddess could bless him for the continuation of his rule. The tradition of sending a sword representing the king began during the time of King Jayaprakash Malla, who happened to be the last Malla king of Kathmandu. All the Shah kings maintain the tradition of sending a royal sword every year to Shaku during the festival of Bajrayani. One might determine the tradition might have stopped as the country has turned into a republic, but despite the death of kingship, the tradition of receiving royal sword continued in Shaku during the festival of Bajrayani. In this way, we see little or no impacts of death of kingship in cultural arena. Now I turn to identity politics. Nepal, a multi-cultural, multilingual, and multi-religious country, hosts more than 100 nationalities or ethnicities, janajati, speaking various languages and dialects. As a result of the 1769 Gorkha Conquest, Nepal underwent a repressive rule of one nation, one culture, one religion, and one language for more than two centuries, which grossly undermined its multinational, multicultural, multilingual, and multi-religious reality. As Nepal has been declared a federal republic, role of identity in Nepalese politics is pivotal. Political parties in Nepal began realizing the importance of identity politics in Nepal as the people of various ethnic nationalities in Nepal with their distinct ethnic, lingual, cultural, and religious background started to express their voice against the domination of the ruling Pahang Chhetri. First, their language, first as only Nepali, their religion Hindu. Ethnic nationalities began to search for identity before and after the political change that took place in Nepal in 1990. Especially, the Communist Party of Nepal Maoist tactfully got the sentiments of these neglected nationalities of Nepal when they began their people's war since 1996. Their exercise of identity politics proved highly successful among the oppressed nationalities in Nepal. The support of ethnic population to the Maoists was important. During the time of their war and after the successful 2006 People's Movement, their slogans, such as to provide equal rights to all nationalities and the languages of Nepal, of federal Nepal based on ethnic identity and the right to self-determination for all nationalities, won wide support from the oppressed nationalities of Nepal. One of the reasons behind the emergence of Maoist as the largest political party from the election of 2008 Constituent Assembly is the slogan in favor of ethnic nationalities of Nepal. Similarly, the violent uprising of Madhesi, the people of southern plain of Nepal, also played an important role in recent identity politics in Nepal. Therefore, not only the Maoist and the Madhesi, but also all existing political parties in Nepal now have made identity politics as one of their main agenda. Of course, there exist differences in opinion among these parties, and some even downplay identity politics, but nevertheless, all of them speak about identity politics. As the country has been declared a republic and the restructuring of the state is in process, diverse ethnic nationalities are eager to see the change to their benefit. However, the heel bound have been trying to prevail against empowering the oppressed. Despite the country has been declared a federal democratic republic, discriminatory policies of the state saw no footstop in Nepal. The chauvinistic mindset of the ruling class has not changed and appeared undeterred and succeeded at dissolving the elected Constituent Assembly in 2012, preventing it from drafting a new constitution. All political parties, as well as ethnic nationalities in Nepal, are using identity in their discourse for their own benefit. Though the activity of the Nepal Federation of Indigenous Nationalities of Nepal, Nepal's ethnic nationalities began to assert their identity as equally important ones as that of the ruling caste people. The violent Madhesi uprising in 2007 has established the identity of the Madhesi as the most prominent one in Nepalese politics. And there is no doubt certain parties or groups have pursued identity politics for their political expediency, but there are genuine grievances related to excluded groups within and outside Kathmandu. Discrimination based on language, culture, and religion are points to be mentioned here. All the facilities are concentrated in the center, and the other regions are exceedingly neglected from every aspect: development, communication, transportation, health, education, etc. In the past, when the neglected ethnic groups raised their voice for equal rights in their languages, culture, and religions, they were either ignored or condemned. As a result of Maoist people's war, people began to reassert importance of identity politics. Later, only when the Madhesi people acted violently for their identity, the power center began to respond positively to their to certain extent. This has made it clear that the center is not prepared to listen voices of neglected groups unless the groups apply violent method of action. Therefore, it can be presumed if the state fails at fulfilling grievances of these neglected ethnic nationalities and the bound to propel their domination, Nepal might see more violence in the near future. Now I shall talk about current political situation in Nepal. It is a great setback to newly created Republic of Nepal that the elected Constituent Assembly was dissolved without decreeing a new constitution on 28 May 2012. The CA was dissolved as a result of failure in finding a consensus on the issues of on the issue of restructuring of the state, especially on the issue of federalism. The major political party rigid stance resulted in the failure of its Constituent Assembly. The long-awaited election of the Constituent Assembly was completed in April 2008, and Nepal received an elected Constituent Assembly with 601 members, winning 227 CA seats. The ex-rebel Maoist became the single largest party, but they failed to win the majority that enabled them to form a single party government. The two old parliamentary parties, the ANC and the Union, won only 115 and 107 seats respectively. You can see the party's position in the last council assembly. The three new Tarai-based Madhesi parties, which were engaged in violent agitation to create a single province in Tarai, won 82 seats in total, enabling them to bargain for power and rights. Other fringe parties and the independent candidates won the remaining seats. The first sitting of the newly elected CA on 28 May 2008 declared Nepal a federal democratic republic. Subsequently, on 11 June, the ex-king Ganendra Shah gracefully exited his palace. In a press conference hours before his departure, the ex-king publicly accepted the result of the Panchayat assembly, defended his action as the king, and repeated the allegation he and his family members were involved in the 1st June 2001 Paris massacre. He also denied having any property in Arjun land in either his name or that of any members of his family. On 21 July, the Panchayat Assembly elected the president and vice president of the newly declared republic. For last minute alliance among the Nepalese Congress and the United Marxist Leninists and the Madhesi Janadhikar Forum succeeded at installing the ANC candidate, Dr. Rambaran Yadav, as the first president of Nepal. It was a significant breaking with the traditional dominance of Hill Brahmins and Chhatris that such a prestigious post went to a Madhesi for the first time. Toward the end of August, almost 5 months after the election, the Maoists, as the largest party in the Constituent Assembly, succeeded in forming a new government with the United Marxist Leninists, the Madhesi Janadhikar Forum, and a few other fringe parties, and the ANC, Nepali Congress, the second largest party, chose to stay in opposition. The interim constitution emphasized consensus among the parties in the formation and the running of the government in the process of making the new constitution. In June 2008, however, the ANC, Nepali Congress, United Marxist Leninists and the Madhesi Janadhikar Forum, Tarai-based party, forced the Maoists to agree in amending the interim constitution in favor of a majoritarian system of forming a government. This has the basis of rival parties to engage in the same old game of toppling government after government that pushed the country into a stage of turmoil in the mid-1990s. As was predicted, the first elected government of the Republic of Nepal last month. It failed within the short span of 9 months with the support of the Nepali Congress and Madhesi Party. Madhav Kumar Nepal, twice defeated in constituent assembly election, succeeded to the post of Prime Minister. It was surprising for everybody because this person was defeated in direct election from two places, but somehow he was picked up as second Prime Minister in Republic of Nepal. When the CA failed to allow discussion of the motion of Maoists presented against the President's move, the country became witness to prolonged street protests by the Maoists for almost a year. It is notable that the Constituent Assembly was elected only for a term of 2 years, and that its single major task was to make a new constitution. However, little progress toward the drafting of the new constitution was made in the around 2 years' time. The interim constitution allowed for the extension of the Constituent Assembly by 6 more months, but on 28 May 2010, at the last moment before its expiration, Prime Minister Madhav Kumar Nepal tendered his resignation, but it took them 9 months before they could elect next Prime Minister. This was a significant setback to the possibility of agreeing a new constitution within the already extended period. Finally, in February 2011, Jananath Khanal, the chairman of the United Marxist Leninist Party, was elected as prime minister after 17 tedious rounds of election, but this time with the support of the Maoists. Amidst great uncertainty, the term of the Constituent Assembly had to extend by another 3 months on 29 May 2011. Jananath Khanal had to resign as Prime Minister again, and Baburam Bhattarai, Maoist Vice Chairman, succeeded him on 29 August 2011. As the party's scrimmage continued, the drafting of the new constitution remained unfinished, and the extended period given to the CA expired, Constituent Assembly expired on 28 May 2012. At the same time, this Constituent Assembly has been automatically dissolved because months before this happened, the Supreme Court ordered not to extend the life of the Constituent Assembly beyond 28 May 2012. This has pushed the country into a tunnel of great uncertainty. At present, we have an election government presuming to hold another election of the Constituent Assembly, ironically, but led by the sitting Chief Justice, Mr. Khilraj Regni, who in fact put to an end to the life of Constituent Assembly without allowing it to complete its historic task of issuing a new constitution. We are now witnessing squabbling among the parties on many issues, including the legitimacy of the present election government. Although the contending parties are ready to vote for a new election of Constituent Assembly to draft a new constitution, the situation remains extremely uncertain, including Mohan Baidi's Maoist party. This is one Maoist party split from the mainstream Maoist party. And the 33 fringe parties are against the election, since the four big parties are controlling the state mechanism without considering grievances of small party. Prachanda's Maoist party and the Nepali Congress and the United Marxist Leninist Party are claiming to return with two-thirds seats in the new Constituent Assembly, but there is no guarantee if any of these parties would gain that many seats. It is most likely that none of these parties would be able to gain majority seats in the Constituent Assembly. Undoubtedly, the conflict between the parties will continue. This would mean repetition of the same drama again in the next term of the Constituent Assembly. Since the first Constituent Assembly failed in writing a new constitution after all the extended periods of time, there is no certainty that newly elected Constituent Assembly would come up with any good result. Therefore, people fear that the country might face an unprecedented crisis even after the election of Constituent Assembly. The Nepalese people are anxious that wrangling among the major political parties may instigate more chaos in the country. I end reading my text here. I'll show some slides after that. So, again, during the time of movement. So here you see how important it used to be in the past for cultural state. You see King Birendra was killed in 2001 Palace Massacre, extending a sword with Goddess Bhadrakam. It was in 1992. So the transition you see, what happened? This is in 2006, even after the change, Ganendra was still functioning as an important person during in the Japa festival. Then in 2007, Prime Minister Girija Prasad replaced him. In 2008, we elected a president in Nepal, President Rambaran Yara, replaced in the Japa festival, the most important festival in Kathmandu. So, again, we talked about identity politics, why people in Nepal are complicated, there are ethnic nationalities, because state mechanism, all high posts are controlled by one ethnic group, especially Brahmins, and elsewhere they are known as Brahmins, but in Nepal they are known as Hindu Brahmins. When Janjati people or minority people ask for rights, they are not ready. So because of this reason, actually, the elected Council Assembly dissolved even after 4 years. It couldn't keep constitution in Nepal. Janjati and the women fighting for their right. So this is last slide. You can see there is a lot of change, but for ordinary people, no change yet. So I end my.
Thank you.
So, seems in effect that 6 years after the end of the monarchy, and I guess I don't even know if Ganendra is still in the country, 6 years after the end of the monarchy, it's as if there never was a monarchy in terms of politics?
In terms of politics, actually one small party called National Democratic Party in Nepal, small party who also contested 2008 CA election, they get less than 100,000 votes, and they still live for monarchy in Nepal. But all other parties, they don't
Is any member of the royal family still in Nepal, and are they playing any role themselves in politics?
Not really. King Ganendra still lives in Nepal. Ex-King Ganendra, but he kept silent.
Not even behind the scenes?
Behind the scenes, yeah. He sometimes visits temples, he supported me, voicing for returning king, but nevertheless, he's not playing politics yet.
It's just sort of amazing how fast it's disappeared.
Right. It is wrong to do so because as people of Kathmandu Valley, they had access in education, and for a certain period of time, they could occupy certain high posts in government. Nevertheless, they were never given any opportunity in decision-making bodies. For instance, they were Prime Minister who was there just before 1990 change in Nepal. He was one senior Prime Minister. He didn't have distant talk. The distant were done from Paris. and the Paris, the Paris, when you talk about Paris, this circle is from Brahmin setting. So, in terms of discrimination faced by ethnic population in Nepal, we can put in the same category. Newars also have been facing same. Newar do not access, do not have access in court. They cannot use their language. They cannot use their language in education sector, administrative sector, or judicial sector. It is same for all other languages speaking people. So this is the reason why Newar and all other people, all other ethnic groups join in this meeting, which is a joint body of all nationalities of Nepal against Brahmin Chet. To whom? You mean the government or the ethnic minorities?
Yeah.
Very actually, all the sub INGOs or the international communities, the governments support the rulers. But little money, for instance, if hit one INGO from UK supported empowering Janjati for certain language training courses, this kind of stuff. But this is very good.
Yeah,
Nepal
has kind of a big question everyone's always asking, but I'm interested to hear your opinion. How long do you think that Nepal can sustain this much pressure of existing without a constitution for a
religion? It's very difficult question. Nobody can hear me. So everybody is educated in Nepal. The parties are blamed for this. Who is doing the right thing? We are not yet sure. So on the one hand, these parties try to convince that now we're holding new election and we give a new constitution, but people are not ready to accept this chair either. This is the answer to me.
Do you think there's...
How long?
Well, no, not how long. God, I suppose. Do you think there's a high percentage of a chance that the minority party that's calling for a return to kingship might gain more voice as
It is possible. Percentage of support of the king might increase, but I don't think it will be sufficient enough to bring back king, because don't have a popular king. Ganendra was so unpopular, everybody just didn't like
him. So,
and his son is so terrible, people didn't like his name. He's now not in Nepal, he was not expat, but he was in self-exile. Now he lives in Bangkok. Recently, the news was that he was in hospital almost dead. The reason was drug addiction. So that kind of person happened. So,
would you find the parties unable to agree on anything? Are any regions talking about literally breaking away, like the Madhesis declaring independence, or some of the ones in the far west or the far east?
Yeah, such things might happen. For instance, Madhesis, though they are still with this four-party mechanism, so they are in a way okay. Yeah, but other Janjati parties, Janjati population, for instance, in east, Limbus. what they are talking now is, if these parties do not listen to us, we will declare our own constitution and we will declare our own state ourselves.
Rise with them.
He'll be able to do that, you know, because they don't have the armed power. They have the willpower. The people are behind them.
Some people in Nepal still think the king is the symbol of the nationality, and some people still think after the death of the kingship, the nationality is kind of weak. Do you agree on that, or what's your view?
There's one theory that the king is the symbol of national unity. That was the theory during the 30 years of Panchayat time. But people realize that this is not the case in Nepal, because during the time of kingship, all these small nationalities were badly suppressed. And they were not given any rights to their culture, to their language, their religion, etc. So they think they don't want king anymore, because he didn't do any good. They don't think he's symbol of national unity.
As an anthropologist, do you see anything?
Sorry?
You are the anthropologist, what do you think about people still demanding the king? Does that affect the future of the country?
As I already said, only one party belongs to the common Thapa, ex-Home Minister of King Janendra. His party is pleading for king. But if you see all those former supporters of king, for instance, the National Democratic Party, Raprapa, they are not anymore talking about kings. They said the country has moved ahead without king already, and we have, the history cannot be stepped back. So this means there is only few people who really want to get that king in Nepal. So I don't know if they can increase the size of supporter in near future. Between two lines, one who support federalism based on identity of small nationality, and one who talk about federalism but not identity based federalism. So we have Nepali Congress, central left party, and one communist faction, United Marxist Leninists. They are close in this matter. They don't want to decree a constitution that would based on identity. Whereas the Maoist party, two Maoist party nowadays, and other small party, and newly formed Federal Socialist Party, all these parties, they may come together in the during election because they are in favor of federalism based on identity.
So what do you think of the idea of federalism?
I think of it.
It's good because in the last 250 years, except one community, namely inbound settling Khoss community who speak Khoss language, they were the only privileged people in terms of access to all resources. So if what Nepalese people think nowadays is that if federalism is granted, this will be decentralized. In the local different ethnic group might benefit from this.
What role do you see for civil society groups and occupy movements and that sort of thing to create pressure towards a new constituent assembly and constitutional process?
What
do you think, like the civil society groups?
Civil society groups, of course, there is a civil society group. They were really effective during or before 2006 people's movement. But what happened after 2006 is that the civil society also now is divided. So several civil societies we have, they are according to the political lines. So the unity is not there, but the civil society is pressurizing for new assembly. Or there is also a talk that if the digital constituent assembly could be reintroduced and just declared constitution, that also can be one solution, immediate solution, instead of having new election and spend another 5 years. It is there is little chance for this, I guess.
I wondered if you happen to have a slide of the before and after map of the districts in Nepal and what it looks like now, what those federal states look like. Do you have that in here? The new looks like. Yeah. And what they're proposing.
Actually, the name, this one is proposed by the Maoist party. Different party of Nepal proposed different structure for federalism. Some have seven provinces, some have 11, some have 10, this is 40.
I also wondered about, a couple of years ago, there was something about a Newar state, an independent Newar state. What became that?
Not independent Newar state. It is a Newar state within Nepal. Actually, it's very small.
Oh, there. Oh, okay.
Newar. So in the past, our country was divided into 75 districts and 14 zones and 5 development regions. But the division was made mixing of different ethnic groups in all places that brought some conflict among people.
These are now sort of a mixture of both ethnic identity units and, I mean, cultural ethnic groups like Newa and Taru and Bugger. So, but then there's these ones on the far left that don't relate to an ethnic group. They're placed which are river-based.
Actually, this tree now, one is named as copter forest, and another is Khasan, belong to Khas.
Oh, okay, so they are going very deep. Any other questions? Thank you very much for coming.